Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Welcome to the newest, the greatest, the most spectacular show in entertainment history. Put your hands together for the Fabulous Feebles Variety Hour.
In 1989, Peter Jackson released Meet the Feebles, a raunchy and ultraviolet spoof of the usually family-friendly genre of puppetry. I have come to adore this film and recommend it to those who appreciate a good laugh. One character, however, stuck in my mind more than others, that character being Harry the Bunny. Harry is a rabbit who, during the movie's runtime, contracts an unnamed disease, causing him to believe he's going to die.
It's the big one, Harry.
No, no, not the big one!
I'll have to notify the health authorities.
We are left to watch as Harry becomes more disheveled and eventually vomits on stage. As humorous as a talking bunny vomiting on stage is, we don't actually get to know the cause of this antic until the end of the film, where Harry is told his disease isn't as serious as once thought, and he runs out the room, exclaiming this.
I'm in the clear, everybody! I haven't got it! I haven't got myxomatosis! I haven't got myxomatosis!
I don't have myxomatosis. This phrase reminded me of something I hadn't thought about in years. A disease I recalled from my early memories of childhood. A mother's warning against all things wild and cotton-tailed. And this led me to wonder, for the first time in almost a decade, what the hell is myxomatosis? I grew up in the quaint little village of Yarwell. Having lived here since I was 6 years old, I've come to know the place off by heart, and have come to enjoy the country lifestyle it has provided me, with wonderful churches, modest streets, and an abundance of sheep. It's safe to say that this is not the worst place to bring up a child, but that doesn't mean there were not horror stories lurking amongst a pretty facade, as I would soon find out one day, in the inconspicuous Sulahay Woods. While not an overly intimidating space, the woods provided the location for one of my greatest childhood phobias, as it was here that I first was told of the dreaded rabbit killer. Walking through the woods one day, I recall seeing a rabbit in the bushes. Upon requesting I pet the bunny, however, I was met with a resounding no from my mother. Inciting disease and other nasty happenings, this was where I first heard of the dreaded myxomatosis, and from my mother's original description, to my young mind, it sounded a little like this.
There was a strange sound, hissing. The air turned bad. Runs blocked with dead bodies. I couldn't get out.
Of course, this is exaggerated thinking, but now that I recall it, what actually is myxomatosis? I didn't know. Was it the horror I imagined it to be as an 8-year-old? I decided to ask someone with a little more expertise than myself to find out. What is myxomatosis?
So myxoma virus is the cause of myxomatosis. It's a type pox virus, and it affects predominantly rabbits' hairs, what are called lagomorphs.
What are the symptoms of that?
In most cases, the initial symptoms are skin related. So you get these particular types of swellings or myxoma, which develop particularly around the head and the face and genital region of the rabbit. But it can spread over the whole body, so effectively the whole rabbit ended up with that skin.
Is anything else up into it, or is that most of it?
In rabbits that have a good level of immunity, then sometimes they will only get the skin symptoms. But in a rabbit that doesn't have a natural immunity, then that progresses fairly quickly to secondary problems. Most viruses don't kill their patients directly. They kill their patients as a result of interference with the immune system. So with rabbits particularly, they end up with respiratory infections and usually die.
How does it spread between, like, rabbit to rabbit?
It can spread directly rabbit to rabbit through body secretions and skin-to-skin contact. The reason it's spread so rapidly, though, is because it's actually spread by insect vectors. So mosquitoes, fleas, and other parasites can act as carriers of the virus. The virus doesn't actually grow in the insect, but it can be transmitted from one to another.
How does that affect the rabbit population in the UK?
When myxomatosis was first introduced back in the 1950s, it very quickly killed off a very large percentage of the rabbit population. Since then, the usual processes of natural selection have resulted in a population which has become progressively more immune to the virus. So until and unless the virus significantly changes, probably about 40-50% of rabbits now will survive in the wild, our rabbit population.
Do you see it a lot in domesticated rabbits?
I wouldn't say a lot now. We certainly used to see it quite a lot going back even 10, 15 years. It affects pet rabbits in the same way that it affects wild rabbits, again, because of this business of insect carriage from one individual to another. And pet rabbits generally seem to be less resistant, shall we say, than wild rabbits. So actually it can be pretty catastrophic for pet rabbits. And because a large percentage of pet rabbits now are vaccinated, we tend to find that when myxomatosis does occur, it doesn't affect them as severely as it did, but we still do see them every year. We'll see a few rabbits that have been affected and probably will die.
So there it was. Myxomatosis is a horror show. But not the horror show I imagined. In my young mind, I assumed this disease was some kind of panic-driven fear fest amongst the burrows of bunnies. But instead I found out it is nothing but a sad, slow, and painful demise to an innocent rabbit. But now I knew the what, and then thought of why. During the interview of Dr. Young, he mentioned it being introduced in the 1950s. And I asked more about that line of thought.
You mentioned before it was introduced in the 1950s. Do you know how it was introduced to the unit?
Okay. So the virus itself originally developed in South America, we think, but certainly in the Americas. And it was just a natural disease affecting lagomorph species in those places. And then it was deliberately introduced in Australia in about 1950. To control the European rabbit population, which was becoming a pest, and did so very successfully. There was a French landowner who actually introduced some infected rabbits as a means of population control into his estate in France. This was, I think, 1952. And I think his original intention was just to control rabbits within that actual environment, within his own land. Unfortunately, I suspect that they hadn't fully understood how it could be spread through these insect carriers, and therefore it spread very, very rapidly and decimated the rabbit population of the whole of Europe.
Hmm. It got to the UK presumably by accident then?
Well, I guess so. I imagine that it would have been carried again possibly by insects, because insects, we know that insect vector diseases can spread across the channel perfectly feasibly. Or it could have been spread by people bringing in rabbits either as meat trade or unlikely as a pet at this stage, I suspect, but possibly.
After the interview of Dr. Young, I began looking further into the disease's development and discovered an interesting narrative. It was indeed used as a pest control agent in Australia as of 1950, and used to cull the rabbit population of Australia since European settlers had brought the species over and had created an ecological nightmare.
It was good news indeed.
However, it wasn't this action that caused the devastation of modern-day myxomatosis. Instead, this can be attributed to one Paul Felix Armand Delisle, a French physician who had the not-so-clever idea to use infectious disease to control a plot of land spanning only 3 kilometres. Obviously, this did not go to plan, and as Dr. Young said, the disease practically annihilated the population of rabbits by 90%. So the answer to why is very simple. One man had a terrible idea and nearly decimated a species, and if he had taken just a little more time to research the highly infectious disease he was throwing around willy-nilly, then perhaps I wouldn't even be talking about it right now. Either way, I now understood the rather foolish why behind the spread of myxomatosis. But now I look towards a new question. How does it affect the world around us? And what are the people's experience with the failing rabbit population? I asked people from different backgrounds or experience with the rabbit population, and whether they noticed its decline. I looked towards the neighbouring village of Nassington to find out.
So, where did you grow up?
So I grew up in Germany, near Frankfurt, in a small town called Königstein im Taunus. So it's in the mountains, what's known as the Deutsche Mittelgebirge, the German middle-sized mountains.
So what was like the sort of atmosphere wildlife-wise around that area?
Yeah, so there's a lot of forest there. So when you go in the forest, you get deer, you get wild boar sometimes. There's a lot of foxes. So we were always told, don't eat the raspberries because they could have fox bandworms in there if the foxes have been licking them.
What was the rabbit population like there? Was it significant or...?
So we didn't really get that many rabbits there.
Right. Was there a significant decline in that? Did you remember them being more when you were growing up and it got lower? Or was it always this low?
As far as I remember, I think it was just always low.
What sort of time period did you live in Germany, like 20, 30 years ago?
Yeah, so from when I was 8 to when I was 19, which would be like the 80s to mid-90s.
So it's always just been quite low in Germany around that area?
Yeah, I think maybe you get those more in the lowlands.
Yeah.
Like, maybe they don't like mountains.
Further research on the German rabbit population showcased that it was not that rabbits did not like the mountains. They were simply dead. Myxomatosis had spread to Germany by the point of the 1980s and had a lot of casualties.
So you said you moved to America afterwards.
I did. In 2001, I moved out to California for about 15 months. Mm. And then I was in a very urban setting and I don't think I saw a rabbit the entire time I lived there. And then 2002 I moved to New Jersey, Princeton area, which is fairly rural again. And I would say we saw a similar level of rabbits coming through our garden there. We got a lot more deer than we ever did in the UK. So deer would come to the garden and
so the wildlife population in New Jersey is
probably similar.
Yeah, similar to the UK.
I would have thought so, especially down there. Other parts of New Jersey are much more developed than that, and corresponding at a lower level. And I'd say, on the whole, we saw about as many rabbits through the garden there as we did in Oxfordshire.
Yeah. Where did you say you lived after that?
And then after that, I moved north to Woodbridge, New Jersey, which is a much more suburban setting. Mm-hmm. And we still would often have rabbits in the garden there. Mm-hmm. We'd see skunks there on a fairly frequent basis. Mm-hmm. You were best advised not to startle them.
So, in general, you'd say the North American population from where you were rurally is kind of similar to the rural UK where you grew up? And
I would have thought so.
Further research showed the US was not free of the virus, but it was more common in the domesticated rabbit than in the wild. but even then so rare that most vets don't carry any treatment on hand and don't even vaccinate against it. So, where did you grow up?
In Maharashtra, Mumbai.
Mumbai? So, India?
Yeah, India, Bombay.
Yeah. What was it like growing up there?
It's a city life, so it's like fast life like London.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So, quite built up, quite...
It's built up, yeah, like London city, proper city.
Hmm. Did you ever go outside to see any wildlife at all?
Yes, I've been some of the wildlife, some of the places.
Yeah.
So it's like in Maharashtra, there is one of the jungles I visited, and I see some of the wild animals, wild buffaloes, then reindeers, deers, tigers.
So outside the city is quite a large wildlife population in India.
Large, yeah. I've been to then Gujarat, one of the wildlife. There is more lions in there. I've seen lots of lions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So did you notice in India quite a lot of rabbits or a rabbit population at all?
There is a rabbits, but you don't see in the cities. You have to go around in the field and... area in the jungles.
Yeah. India has never actually had a recorded presence of myxomatosis. It's actually showcased in the numbers, as India's rabbit population has actually increased in recent years. Funny how not having a notorious lagomorph killer can sustain the bunny population. One thing I noticed when filming this documentary was the lack of rabbits I saw when actively trying to see them. Only once did my crew and I spot a rabbit while filming, or many rabbits. As you can see, we were rather frantic when we saw them, but it made me realise that all those years that I've lived in my quaint little village, I'd seen the little fellas less and less. Perhaps it's just the seasons changing, but part of me remembers how it was years ago, seeing all their little fluffy faces, peering out of their burrows, but now I see little to none. And as sad as all that is, I can find comfort in another reason to dislike the French.
Les rêves des amoureux sont comme le bon vin. Ils donnent de la joie ou bien du